个点，我有啊，但还没转圆呢，它好像小。I had seen that for the Hamiltonian to be Hermitian, X has to be Hermitian. And we also saw that for the Hamiltonian to be gapless, X cannot have a zero eigen value. And then we describe the classification of the matrices X with that property. Okay, so that was the goal of yesterday's talk. Now today we are going to relax some of the assumptions which are not explicitly stated, but which are there in the yesterday's talk. And one set of assumptions that we had made is the specific structure of the Hamiltonian. Okay, namely it has a form AJ dagger AK, and that it didn't have any term of the form AJ AK or AJ dagger AK. So I can make it formal by saying that the Hamiltonian commutes with AK dagger AK or in other words it conserves particles. So what we are going to do today first is to relax this assumption. Okay, we will be trying to work with a more general class of Hamiltonians which do not conserve particles. Okay, later on we'll restore it at some stage. Okay, but right now we'll try to make it a little more general. So we can do that by either working in terms of AJ and AJ dagger and allow for terms like this, or work with real variables. Okay, what are variables? So I write AJ as half C 2J minus 1 plus I times C 2J. Then AJ dagger to be half C2J minus 1 minus I times C2J. And then in terms of this, we have CJ dagger equal to CJ. These are our formulas. And you can easily check that the commutation relation that we had earlier, namely AJ and AK anti commute, AJ dagger, AK dagger anti commute, and AJ and AK dagger have anti commutator delta AK. From this it follows that CJCK anti-commutator is 2 delta. And a general Hamiltonian which doesn't conserve particle number can now be rewritten in the following way. This is just a matter of convention. This normalization is a convention dependent normalization. It's clear that you can always absorb this inside the coefficient A. Okay, but there is some reason why you have to put at least a factor of I outside, as you see. Now we can simplify this in the by writing the following thing. First of all, when J is equal to K, this is just 1, CJ square is 1. So the term here which corresponds to J equal to K, that just gives I by 4 times sum over J, AJ. And then we have I by 4, sum K, A equal to 1 to 2A. And we are J not equal to K, A, J, K, C, J, C. So this is just a constant term, so you can just drop it. Okay, the constant term added to the Hamiltonian doesn't do anything. Here, because C, J, C, K is minus C, K, C, K, we can, without any loss of generality, take AJ to be anti-symmetric. So because if AJ can is symmetric part, it will just give 0. If it is a symmetric part. So we will use this to write AJ as minus AJ. Okay, so we take the R Hamiltonian to be of this form with sum running over J0 equal to K, and then we impose that on AJK is equal to minus AKG. In fact, once you have imposed this, okay, we can get the sum run from JK equal to 1 to, you can just drop this because this term vanishes anyway. Okay, because if AJK is a minus KJ, then AJJ is equal. Now it's easy to check.
Give me an exercise.
Yeah, you want the Hamiltonian to be Hermitian. And this implies that AJK star is equal to AJ minus AJ. AJK star is equal to AJ. Okay, namely A is there. So you get first AJK star equal to minus AKJ by taking the Hermitian conjugate, but then eventually you get this to be equal to AJ. So this one is A is real. So this implies that A is real and this might be matrix. And a real anti-symmetric matrix, of course, we know has eigenvalues. And we have plus minus I lambda j equal to 1. So, okay, I can always take lambda j equal to 1. Because it's plus minus I lambda j. And again, we will assume that lambda j is not equal to 0 because we want to cap get from the gap. Okay, and hence lambda j can be bounded between say alpha and alpha inverse as we did this. Now, yesterday we tried, so our goal will be to classify matrices. Satisfy this condition, okay, or more precisely, classify the topological equivalent classes of matrices, satisfying this condition. So, given two such matrices, A and B, okay, we'll call them topological equivalent. If there is a continuous family of matrices which are real anti-symmetric without gap, whose one end is A, the other one end, other end is B. Right. So if A can be continuously deformed to B via matrices, okay, which are real anti-symmetric and which have no zero eigenvalues, so we'll call A and B to be topological equivalent. And the goal will be to classify such equivalence classes of matrices. Now, what we did yesterday was to, when instead of looking at a real anti-symmetric matrix, we are looking at a Hermitian matrix. We wrote A as U times the diagonal form, that's U dagger. And then we said that we can classify, okay, we can get the family of all such matrices by simply varying U. Okay, once the eigenvalues are fixed. We can try to do that here, but that's not very efficient. And the reason is that if we take, so it is true that A can be written in this form. Okay, any matrix can be diagonalized. Okay, any matrix, any normal matrix, which means if A and A naught are commutative, can be diagonalized, and this A falls in that dagger. Right? So A can be diagonalized as U times complement times U dagger. Okay, where U is the unitary matrix. But the problem is that if we now fix this and let U to be arbitrary unitary matrix, the corresponding A will not be real. Okay. So while it is true that a real anti-symmetric matrix can be brought into this form, the reverse that any matrix of this form is real anti-symmetric is not true. Okay, if I let U to be an arbitrary unitary matrix. So unlike what we did yesterday, okay, unitary matrices are not useful to classify real anti-symmetric matrices, okay, that we ought to classify. So we want to write a more standard form of A, such that as you vary the analog of what appears here U, you always get real anti-symmetric. Okay, because you want to vary in that manner. Okay? You don't want complex matrices as you vary. So here you can use a result, okay, which again I'll leave as an exercise for you if you have not already seen this. And that is that states that given any real anti-symmetric matrix with eigenvalues of plus minus I lambda j, A can be always brought into the form of V times 0 lambda 1 minus lambda 1 0 0 lambda 2 minus lambda 2 0 transpose, where V is real, so V basically belongs to O. So V, V transpose is identity and V is here. Orthogonal matrices, we have to go. So any real anti-symmetric matrix can be brought into this form. And now the reverse is also true. Given a matrix like this, if you calculate V times this times V transpose, it's a real anti-symmetric. So now we can try to generate the family of all real anti-symmetric matrices by varying for given eigenvalues. Are there any questions? So the other thing we did yesterday, okay, was to use the fact that once you have non-zero eigenvalues, okay, the topological classification problem remains the same if we just set the eigenvalues to plus minus 1. Okay, if there's an actual magnitude, doesn't matter. And that in fact holds true here also. Okay. So instead of working to classify matrices of this kind, if lambda is non-zero, we can try to classify matrices. Real anti-symmetric matrices whose eigenvalues are all plus minus 1. Okay, instead of allowing plus minus lambda j, okay, with non-zero lambda j, we just set eigenvalues to plus minus 1, and the classification problem doesn't change. So we take matrices of eigenvalue plus minus 1, okay, and the precise way you can go from the original matrices to the new matrices, the A to A tilde, is simply that given any A, okay, which has a general structure like this, you first determine V, satisfy this, and then we simply take these two. What? So minus V plus minus 5 2. Plus minus. So basically, if A tilde can be deformed to B tilde, then you can deform A to B by first taking A, deforming it to A tilde, then go to B tilde, then from B tilde go back. And the reverse is also true. Okay, you can check that if A can be deformed to B, then you can find a path by which 18 lakh annuity form to do. Yeah, the arguments are exactly identical to what we did yesterday, so I'll not repeat it here. So the upshot is that we will now focus on classifying matrices which are of this form for arbitrary orthogonal matrices V. All arbitrary real lattice symmetric matrices are eigenvalues plus minus 1. And the question is, given two such matrices, how do you know if you can deform one to the other? By a continuous family of matrices of eigenvalues plus minus 1, which are all real lattice. Now, naively, one might think that such matrices are classified by elements of O2n. Because given any element of O2n, we have a matrix. Okay, given any matrix A tilde, you get an element of O2n by doing this. But of course, as we saw yesterday, this is not a complete equivalence. And the reason is that if W belongs to O2n, well, I should give this matrix a name. If this matrix, I'm called Q. Okay, that's to make writing a little simpler. So if there is a W in O2n such that W Q W transpose is equal to Q, then and P W is same. Okay, so not all different V's generate given a data. Okay, you have to borrow out the set of V's which are in O2n by possible multiplication by W from the right, okay, by W satisfies. Okay, so like yesterday, you have to quotient by something. Okay, what do you have to quotient by? You have quotient by the group, okay, which is a group generated by W satisfies this. So it's obviously a subgroup of O2n. Okay? It's a subgroup because W first of all has to belong to O2n. And given any two elements, W1 and W2, which satisfy this, the product of W1 and W2 will also satisfy this. Okay, so that's what shows that W is a sub, generates a subgroup of O2n.
Can we not have done this at the level of writing it with U view that, like if we can find a subspace of U which preserves the fact that with any elements of that subgroup A will always be real?
Yes, we could have done that, but that's a little more. First of all, you have, then the job becomes twofold. The first, you have to determine which U does that, right? And then we have to find a W, okay, which has this property, and then you have to see among those W, which W's keep it real. And you could do that, sir. Okay, it just makes life a little more.
And also, yesterday's analysis.
Yes.
Can I have done it in this basis, V, 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 and up?
Yes, you could. Okay? Except that this is not going to generate the most general Hermitian matrix.
Because the anti symmetric, so that the diagonal is also
good. Yeah. See, yesterday the point is. So, we'll go back to yesterday's analysis in this language. Because yesterday's analysis allowed us to vary among Hamiltonians which commute with this A dagger, the number of order. Right? This general Hamiltonian doesn't commute with the number of order. Right? So you have to impose additional conditions. So not arbitrary anti-symmetric matrices allowed, you have to look at anti-symmetric matrices which commute with the number of order. So we will do that later today. So I'll give the answer to this problem, okay? That namely what subgroup of O2n has this feature that it satisfies WQ, W transpose equal to Q, okay? And it turns out that subgroup is UN. Okay, so O to N has a natural UN subgroup.
Okay.
The way you generate the UN subgroup of O to N is that you combine. So O to N has 2N elements, right?
Okay.
So you essentially go back to defining, instead of using C1, C2 up to C2N, okay, C1 plus IC2 as A1, C3 plus IC4 as A2, and so on. So you have now N complex variables. And then there is a subgroup of O2N, okay, that generates as a UN transformation on that N complex variables. So you can show that if you take that particular subgroup, okay, which can be translated into O2N matrices, then that factor is absent. Is this clear? Okay. So statement, first of all, the statement should be clear. Okay, what we are saying. Right. We are saying that we are looking for O2N matrices W which satisfies this. Okay. Now, you can start W equal to identity. W equal to identity obviously satisfies this. Okay. W equal to Q also satisfies this. Okay. Now, the question is, what other possible matrices satisfy this? You have to generate the whole loop. And the claim is that they generate the grouping matrix. So in this complex notation, if you use this complex notation, but write it slightly differently. So in the complex notation, you can write the matrix as I, Y, and then minus I, up to minus I.
Here W is real, right?
Yes.
How come this?
But UN has real representation also. See, UN is a complex group, but it has real representations. N plus N bar of UN is real. Right? That's what I said. That you take the matrices A1 to, you take the variables C1 to C2N, right? Okay? And then take C1 plus IC2, C3 plus IC4, C2N minus 1 plus IC2N. Okay? And apply a UN matrix on this. Okay. That can be re-expressed as some linear combination of the C1 up to C2N, which are all real linear.
So is it rotating the A's among themselves and the A daggers among themselves?
Yes, that's right. So UN basically acts on the A's, it rotates the A's among themselves, right? And the rotation of the A dagger is automated by the complex one equation. Right? It's not an independent rotation about A dagger. That's how the UN subgroup is. Okay, that's what I was trying to say here, that if you write A, if you write A tilde in this complex rotation, then the UN matrix is generated by U star. Here is U dagger, U star. The dagger matrix.
Topological classes of these matrices will be indexed by connected component of both. If you consider these kinds of matrices, then
no, not necessarily.
We are noting multiple correspondence with these connected components.
But we don't have to assume that it's connected component. Even if it's O2N has disconnected components.
A and B tilde and B and U are in the same connected component, then we can always deform it.
Yeah, but we are not assuming that that's what you want to classify, right?
Yeah.
We are not assuming that A tilde and B tilde are in the same connected component. Okay. Because then they are in the same topological class, right? Right now, you are trying to look for all possible A tildes, okay, which are of the form real anti-symmetric matrix. Then you will have to identify the connected component of that space. Okay? That will generate how many independent topological classes you have. Okay? Right now, when you are trying to look for the instead of all possible A tildes, then there is no restriction that you have to use the connected component.
Sir, this condition WQ, W transpose is again the same. We want to remove those redundancy which we had last.
Yes, exactly.
This is again.
Yeah, it is exactly the same condition, right? That if W belongs to O2N and if it satisfies this, right, then DW transpose is VQ transpose, which is A tilde. Okay? So V and VW generate exactly the same A tilde. That's why you want to remove this. And what I am saying is that this set of W's which satisfy this form the group UN. Okay, you can see it in various different ways, right? In the complex rotation, it's the UU star which acts on this matrix. Okay. Or if you want to see the action of this on the oscillators, okay, it's simply this, that you recombine them into complex oscillators. On this, there is natural action of UN. Take a n by n complex matrix, act on this, okay, and then reinterpret that as C1 prime plus IC2 prime, C2 prime plus IC2, C2 prime, and so on. That gives you C1 prime up to C2 prime as a linear combination of C1 to C1. Okay, and by construction, everything is clear. Okay, so we get it's a UN group, but it's a real representation of UN, right? Because the matrix itself is UN. Is this one clear? The complex group can have real representation. And adjoint representation is always real, for example, right? Irrespective of what group you have. In this case, the representation that we have is the fundamental plus antiparticle. Okay, O2N has a twin dimensional real representation. Right? But that can be thought of as a combination of a fundamental and anti-fundamental.
What is
this?
Is this not the condition for symplectic group?
But symplectic group has to be inside O2N. If you didn't have any other condition, it's a symplectic group. Mm-hmm. Okay? But W is also an element of O2N. Right? So the intersection of the symplectic group and O2N is even. Okay, so the one is not, so it's not an arbitrary matrix W are looking for, which satisfies this. Okay? W has to satisfy this, and at the same time, W has to be inside O2N, which means W transpose W has to be I n. Okay, these two conditions are simultaneously satisfied by the UN subgroup of O2N. Okay? In any case, this is a straightforward algebraic exercise, right? You should be able to verify this. So from this you conclude that the space of real anti-symmetric given by real matrix of eigenvalue plus minus I is O2N on E. There is a matrix classification problem. Okay. But now we go to K-theory, okay, which means that it now allows you to compare matrices of different dimensions. Okay. So, like yesterday, we appended matrices of the form 1 minus 1, 1 minus 1, diagonal 1 minus 1, 1 minus 1, right? That was the standard matrix we added. So in this case, the standard matrix that we will be adding is that A tilde is equivalent to B tilde if A tilde, for example, B tilde and 0, 1, minus 1, 0, 1, minus 1. Because you consider A tilde to be equivalent to a matrix where you appended to, or B tilde to be equivalent to a matrix where you appended arbitrary number of blocks of the form 0, 1, minus 1, 0, 0, 1, minus 1, 0, minus 1. Okay, so this is the analog of what we added yesterday as 1 minus 1, 1 minus 1.
Connected.
Well, I haven't said anything so far. That's what you have to determine, right? This is the space of matrices, right? Now we have topological classification, which I have not done. Right, which I will be doing now. But first, I extended the definition to game theory, so like we expand the matrix. Okay, and this basically means that the set of matrices, this space, will actually take the inverse to infinity limit of this space.
Okay.
This space is will call R. Okay, and that's in the notation will become clear later. R stands for L because we are classifying real matrices. 2 stands for something which is mysterious for now. Okay, we'll see what 2 stands for later. Okay, but we'll just take this definite. We'll call the space R2 as this space. Okay, we are taking the inverse to infinity limit because we can append arbitrary matrices. Okay, so any matrix can be thought of as equivalent to an infinite dimensional matrix by simply appending arbitrary number of elements of this kind, 0, 1, minus 1, 0, 0, so you always map everything to infinite dimensional matrices. Okay, and so the space that you have to look at is this space, O to M1. And what we are interested in computing is the number of connected components of this space, right? Because if you have a space, okay, which is connected, then you can always find a path from any point to another point. Right? That's the definition of a connected space. Okay. On the other hand, the space consists of several disconnected components, like this, for example. Right? Suppose you have one dimensional space made of several circles. Then any 2 points on this component can be continuously formed each other, right? By because there's a continuous path. Means that you can continuously deform, maintaining all the properties like this, but a point here and a point here cannot be connected. Okay? So what you are looking for in the classification problem is the number of connected components that are to this. And there is a symbol that is used to denote that, that's called y0 of R. Okay, this is a zero homology. Right? Zero is homotopy of R. Okay, just the name doesn't matter, it just counts the number of disconnected components on.
You're doing the same thing like yesterday,
right?
You're trying to make it into a group by going to a
big. Yeah, space. We have not said, so it will automatically become a group, exactly. But once you have done this, right, it will become a group because you can now compose A tilde and B tilde. The group action has just the matrix A tilde. Yeah, this is a real anti-symmetric matrix. This is a real anti-symmetric matrix. The whole thing is a real anti-symmetric matrix. Okay. And because we have relaxed the dimension, okay, we define a group composition law as A tilde times B tilde is A tilde B tilde. Okay. We'll see later what the inverses and etc. Okay, because we did not make this group.
No, but then why are you taking n to infinity?
Because, like yesterday, we took this un1 plus n2 mod un1 times un2. The space that we considered yesterday was then we took the limit n1, n2 to infinity. Right? Because you can given any set of matrices, right, you can always map it to an arbitrarily big matrix by appending that 1 minus 1, 1 minus 1. Okay. So, because different dimensional matrices are all equivalent, right, if you just fix the given dimensional matrix, okay, that by itself doesn't capture all the possible. You cannot, for example, sum over all the dimensions of the matrix, right, because different matrices of different dimensions can be equivalent by appending it 1 minus 1. So the easiest way to classify is think of this as infinite dimensional matrix. Because given any finite dimensional matrix, you can convert to infinite dimensional matrix by adding this 1 minus 1. So always take any matrix, map it to an infinite dimensional matrix. Okay, and then do the classification problem there. Okay? When can one be deformed to R? Because if they can be deformed as a finite dimensional matrix, they can also be deformed as infinite dimensional matrix. Okay? Because if A can be deformed to B, or if A tilde can be deformed to B tilde, then A tilde appended with arbitrary number of matrices can be deformed to B tilde appended with the same number of matrices. Okay? So that's why any deformation problem we can always reformulate as a problem in infinite dimensional space. Okay, where matrices have infinite dimensional.
So, but yesterday we defined the space using the sum of closure space from N1, N2, from 0 to infinity. And
yes.
Here you just take the limit, so what is the difference between the two?
Because yesterday, well, the difference is that in this case, that there is no notion of N1 positive and N2 negative eigenvalues. Okay? Yeah, it has equal number of positive and negative eigenvalues. Right? So this is the full classification of the matrices. See, yesterday the power, okay, maybe I can pull this one. That yesterday if we had say N1 positive and N2 negative eigenvalues, then by appending 1 minus 1, 1 minus 1, the difference N1 minus N2 cannot be changed. Okay? That's why you have different sectors over which you have to sum. Here, a priori there is no such concept. So you can take an infinite dimensional matrix and you can try to classify. Because you are always allowed to append 0, 1, minus 1, 0.
That comes because we change from A negative to C.
Yes, because you are working with C and you have said that eigenvalues are all plus minus sign.
If at all, we could have taken N1, N2, 2, 3, we can any finite elements are probably to be captured in B.
So we did. We did N1, N2, N3. Yes. Because otherwise, if we did, it couldn't have become Z, right? So ultimately, we got the result for the K group to be Z. Right? Group.
Yes, sir, we wrote it just as a direct sum.
Oh, yeah, direct sum. See, yeah. Direct sum for N1.
Well,
maybe okay, maybe I should have said this. I could have taken direct sum of N1 N2, but N1 plus N2 equal to infinite. Maybe I didn't write this explicitly. Okay, right? Or N1 plus N2 equal to infinite. Okay, but I should have written, I wrote N1 N2 both going to infinity, but that is not necessary. N1 plus N2 has to go to infinity. Okay? N1 N2, one of them could be within finite. Okay? But total dimension of the matrix. We take it by appending 1 minus 1, 1 minus 1 arbitrary number. N1 plus N2 is total dimension of the matrix.
But if we suppose we have a finite N1 and finite N2, and like one appending this 1 minus 1,
yes.
Then both N1 and N2 become infinite, right? Because I have same number of.
That is true. Yes, that is true. So you could take N1 and N2 to infinity. It doesn't really make that much difference. Right? The important point is the total dimension of the matrix has to go to infinity. Okay? Yeah, so that's the main point. So, because if you take a very large matrix, right, you have a possibility that all of these elements are 1 and the other one is minus 1. Right? For a very big matrix. See, that's why you got Z. See, what is Z? Z contains elements from minus infinity to infinity. Right? If you are taking the element which is going towards infinity, that means the number of positive minus number of negative eigenvalues is going to be infinity. Right? That's also an allowed element of this group.
So is it important to take the limit into infinity because for small and minor trivial, for large and you get something non trivial.
For small
values of n, why not or to be, okay, for small individual, but it's only large.
Yes, if you take very, 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 very small, if you take n equal to 0,
not n equal to 1, 2 is still trivial, but for large n equal, that's the difference.
Well, even for n equal to 1, 2 in this case, it will not be trivial.
Okay. So 1 will be 4 to 1,
yeah, but O2 is n. See, why not of O2 is n?
No, but it's mod U2, also, mod U1, so it doesn't be trivial.
Yeah, but UN is connected. Okay, we will write down what it is. Okay, let me write pi out of it. See, typically what one can show is that in any problem like this, that for small enough n, the result may depend on n. Okay, but as long as you take large enough, okay, the result becomes independent.
That's what you want.
Yes, that's what you want. Okay, because you define what you define case theory good that way. In this case, even for n equal to 2, you already reached that point. Okay, n equal to 2 and n equal to infinity give the same value of pi 0. Okay, so pi 0 of R2 essentially consists of two elements. Okay, we have not really yet determined what the group is. Okay. It contains two elements. Here okay, I'll describe what those two elements are. So those two elements are labeled by two different elements of both men. Okay. One element is just identity. This is one particular representative element of both men. You can take many others. The other one is minus 1, 1. Okay, see, what are we trying to classify? We are trying to classify the number of connected components of O2N, number of components of O2N, right, which are disconnected from each other. But you don't want to connect all possible components, you have to model by them. Okay, but because event is connected, it doesn't really make a difference. Okay, whether we model by event or not. Okay, so pi 0 of O2N mod event is the same as pi 0 of O2N. And O2N has basically two components. One are matrices of determinant 1, the other one matrices of determinant minus 1. Okay, so you can take the representative to be either identity or one identifier minus 1 rest side. So every other O2N matrix can be continuously connected to either this one or that.
This is the parity and the normal.
Yes, you can think of it as parity, but here of course it's not really parity, it's acting on an internal aspect, right? But yes, this is determinant minus 1.
Can you again explain that pi 0 of R2 means it's connected?
Pardon?
This pi 0 of R2 means it?
Pi 0 of R2, what it is? This is the number of disconnected components. If a space, R2 is this space, then it's a set of O2N matrices up to multiplication by UN matrix from a line. Pi 0 is counting how many disconnected components it has. So a disconnected component means the space is a combination of three circles. Pi 0 will be, there are three elements. This is first element, this is second element, this is third element. Okay? So far you have not said anything about group property, right? So you cannot, so given an arbitrary space, you don't have, it doesn't have a group property. Okay? So it does a collection of these three elements. That's the set. Okay? So here, it will be a set of two objects. One is this one, the other one is this one. Okay? But let's see what it means in terms of AKL. Yes.
Why? Pi 0 of R2 is equal to pi 0 of O2N.
Well, the R2 by definition is this space.
Yes, sir. Slash UN.
Slash UN. Okay. But in this case, because UN is connected to, quotient take my UN, it doesn't really make a difference. Okay. So what you can show is that if two elements of O2N are connected, okay, then they remain connected in quotient by UN. If two elements of O2N are not connected, right, if one is in this class and the other one is in this class, they will remain disconnected. Right? There is no continuous path that you can go from, that can take you from here to here. Okay, so the fact that the O2N has two disconnected components can be used to conclude that this space, O2N mod UN, also has two disconnected components.
Because UN is connected.
Because UN is connected.
If UN, as you mentioned about it, there is another matrix at place of UN, which is disconnected.
Then yeah, that could in principle change the topology. Yeah, it could change the topology. So let's look at the representative A tilde from these two sets. So the first representative is where you use the identity element. Okay, so how is integer related to U is this. Okay? Q is the matrix element 0, 1, minus 1, 0, 0, 1, minus 1, 2, and so on. So if U is identity, then A tilde is 0, 1, minus 1, 0. So you see A tilde is basically Q. If U is this other element, minus 1, 1, 1, then A tilde is 0, minus 1, 1, 0. You have to guess which part of the part. But you can see what. Then the first block is 0, minus 1, 1, 0. You got to be minus 1, 1. All other blocks are 0, 1, minus 1, 0, 0, 1, minus 1, 0. Okay. And the claim is that any real antisymmetric matrix with eigenvalues plus minus I can be deformed to either this matrix or this matrix. But there is no way you can deform this matrix to this matrix. Okay, because we have gotten this from these two different elements, which belong to disconnected components over there. Now, given this result, okay, you can now ask, do we have guessed it even before doing all this analysis? Okay, could we know, okay, if we didn't go through this, could we have proven that these two matrices can never be deformed? Okay. Now, there is one way to prove this, which is the following. Okay, so you look at the list here. I have not seen the definition of this. And this is a matrix. Okay, this is defined only for even antisymmetric matrices, even dimension. It's basically epsilon I1, I2 up to I2n, totally antisymmetric matrix, with epsilon 1, 2, 3 up to un being 1. A tilde I1, I2, this you can show is 1 for the first matrix, and minus 1 for the second matrix. Okay, and a continuous deformation, the LCM can be shown not to change. Okay? Continuous deformations are all generated by A tilde going to say W tilde W tilde transpose. Okay, and these do not change this. Okay, you can check. Okay, so the fact that the A tilde, this A tilde, okay, has LCM 1 and this A tilde has LCM minus 1. It can be used to show that it's impossible to deform these things. Other questions?
This will be trivially zero for symmetric matrices.
Yeah, for symmetric matrix of course it will be zero. Right? And it will be zero for if the matrix has zero eigenvalues. Otherwise, if the Pythagorean matrix has no zero eigenvalue, it's anti-symmetric and it has no zero eigenvalue. The Hessian cannot come to zero. And there, the fact that a positive Hessian cannot be deformed for negative Hessian is automatic, because to go from positive value to negative value, you have to go to zero. Okay? And if you are not allowing zero eigenvalues, okay, then the positive Hessian matrix cannot be deformed to negative Hessian. So the fact that these are positive and negative Hessian tells us that they cannot be deformed. Okay? So this is an independent way of checking that it is not possible to deform the image. But then we can ask further questions: how do you know that every matrix can be deformed to one of these two? Okay? For that, the simplest way to see this is formulated. Okay, that I have an O2N has only two disconnected components. Okay? Anything else? Okay, is connected to one of these two components of O2N that I wrote down. And hence any matrix, you just add it as U times Q times U transpose. Okay, and just continuously deform U to either the first matrix or the second matrix. Okay, so that shows that any other matrix can be deformed to one of these. Okay, so now, the Hamiltonian that we just considered, we didn't impose any symmetry, right? Even the particle number conservation, which is associated with the phase symmetry, that we gave up. We wrote down the most general Hamiltonian. Okay, but gap, okay, right? So it has no zero eigenvalue, the matrix has no zero eigenvalue. But otherwise, we didn't impose any other symmetry. Now, we'll see what happens if we further restrict the Hamiltonian to have certain symmetry. Okay. And when you want to restrict the Hamiltonian to have certain symmetries, you will also have deformations via intermediate Hamiltonians with respect to symmetries. Okay. So the topological classification problem that we will be posing now will be modified from what we did earlier. Okay, earlier we gave two Hamiltonians and we asked what are the possible different Hamiltonians which cannot be deformed each other. Now we will be giving again two Hamiltonians, each having some symmetry, and we will be asking that under what condition one can be deformed to the other, maintaining the symmetry. So the symmetry that will be dealing with first is what is called time inversion symmetry. You want to focus on Hamiltonians which have time universal symmetry, and you want to interpolate by Hamiltonians with time universal symmetry. Now, time universal symmetry, you probably have seen that it's an anti-unitary operator. Okay, it's not, its action on the various states is not unitary, complex conjugates and then applies the unitary operation. Okay, so, it's a little state. So, in particular, it changes I to minus I. Okay, whenever in the Hamiltonian you will find that there is the I. Because time universal complex conjugates the state, it will change the I to minus. And on top of that, it can have a unitary complex. Okay, that after you do try to change the I to minus, you can also apply a unitary transformation on the state. So we will be looking at specific form of time universal transformation, okay, which is basically induced from the original time universal transformation of formulas with spin. So we'll assume now that n is even. Okay, already there are two n oscillators. Remember C1 to C2n. We'll further assume that n is even. Okay. And we will group four C's. In the form C1 plus IC2, C3 plus IC4, then C5 plus IC6, C7 7 plus IC and so on. Okay. So basically these are going back to the original A. Basically this is our A. Okay. A's and these are A diagrams. Sorry, A diagrams to this one minus IC2, C2 minus IC4. So we are going back to the A. Okay, even though we are not assuming at this stage that it will have charge level, it will have particle level. Okay. But it's just a useful way to organize the oscillators so that the action of time versus vector becomes easier. Now, why two of them? So these are like two A oscillators. You think of these two as the upper and lower component of a SU2 model. Okay, SU2 is a rotation group. So you think of these as the spin up state, these are the spin down state. Okay, and the SU2 rotation basically acts on this by SU2 transform. Okay, SU2 group. Again, we are not assuming that SU2 is a symmetric. SU2 transformation need not preserve the Hamiltonian. Okay, it's just that you are organizing the various oscillators by its SU2 transformation properties, because the action of prime reversal symmetry is known in terms of SU2 generators. So now I'll say what the time reversal, how time reversal symmetry acts on it. Time reversal symmetry. It acts on this combination C1 plus IC2, C3 plus IC4. So it's all I's have to be changed to minus I's. Okay, and then it has to be followed by a possible unitary transformation. So first we change this to C1 minus IC2, C3 minus IC4. And the unitary transformation that one adds here is what is called I sigma y. But sigma y is the Pauli matrix 0 minus I IC. Okay, this is typically how time reversal symmetry acts on a spin state. That it complex conjugates the state, that means changes all the i's to minus i's, and then it applies this upper trice. Okay. If you have not seen this, let's take this as a definition of time reversal transformation. Okay. So we'll be looking for Hamiltonians which are invariant under this time reversal transformation. Okay. This are, as it is, our definition.
So if we have group differently, then that will be different.
Yes, of course. Because the point is here that, as I said, the idea is that these are the spin up and spin down components of the oscillator. Okay, if you think of the formula as a spin doublet, then this is spin up, spin down, and the time reversal symmetry. If you look at the standard textbooks, you can see that the time reversal transformation acts, that the unitary part of the time reversal transformation is the size of power. Okay, once you have proved them in the spin. Okay. But if you can forget about spin and everything else and just think of this as the definition of time reversal transformation. So you can easily translate this into specific action of C1, C2, C3, C4, right? All you have to do is that this side, for example, so I sigma y is just 0, 1, minus 1, 0, right? So apply 0, 1, minus 1, 0, so it becomes C3 minus IC4 comes on the top, minus C1 plus IC2 comes on the bottom. And then you can compare term by term, so C1, for example, will go to C3, because C3 is the real part on this side. C2 will go to minus C4, and this way you can figure out how each state transforms. Okay. So, I will do an exercise to check that interaction is Ci equals to sum over M Cm P1 where P is this polynomial. It's 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. And it satisfies the following conditions. P square is minus 1, P transpose is minus E, and this implies that P transpose E is identical to 1. 1 means identical. What happens to Hamiltonian? So H tilde was I by 4 sum over J K, you know, equal to K. A tilde J K. I am using A tilde. I have already said all the integrals to plus minus I. C J C K. So this goes to this I still has to be converted to minus I. Because whenever time reversal transformation acts, it should change I to minus I. Because if P acts on this, then that is the same as minus I, that's T acting on this. So on. So this goes to minus I by 4 sum over J K. J tilde J K. Right? Sum over J M. So C J becomes C M P N G C N P N P. So basically this gives you minus I by 4 sum over N N. So this means that time reversal symmetric leads, so H tilde goes to H tilde if P A tilde P transpose equal to minus P minus sign. And then you can multiply by P and use this relation over here. See that P A tilde minus P. So let me write the relations again. So D tilde square, D square is minus 1. P A is minus 13. And there is another relation which I am not writing down. D tilde square is minus 1. Okay, A tilde square equal to minus 1 follows from the fact that A tilde has eigenvalues plus minus I. Right? So when you square it, all the eigenvalues become minus 1. Okay? So when all the eigenvalues are equal, the only possibility is that it has to be minus I.
So
there
will be minus I in the second line?
Second line? Yeah?
Yeah. In the next line, there will be transpose.
No. I didn't see, I didn't transpose, I didn't use dt tilde equal to minus t here. So let me explain, this minus sign here is coming because it's universal symmetry is anti-unitary. Okay? Because it's an anti-unitary transform, it has to kill all the i's to minus sign. Okay? So in going from here to here, okay, this is t mj times a tilde j. Right? So t and a tilde are in the correct order, t times a tilde. Okay? But second one, it's a tilde jk times t mk. Okay? That's why I wrote this as t transpose k. Okay, without using anything on that side. That's why I got t a tilde t transpose. Okay? So the minus sign is basically the same minus sign which came from here. Okay, there is no further minus sign coming from here because I am not using any property of t. And so in going from here to here, of course, I have used the fact that t transpose t equal to. Okay, these relations over here, you may recognize as a relation involving normal matrices. Okay, so let me remind you the relation among the gamma matrices. So recall gamma matrix algebra. Gamma I, gamma j, anti-commutator is 2 eta. Normally, you are used to think of eta ij as 1 minus 1 and all plus 1s, okay, or 1, 1 and all minus 1, depending on your convention. But I'll take a general eta which has minus 1, minus 1, up to minus 1, and 1, 1, 1. Say p minus 1s and q 1s. I will call this algebra the Clifford algebra of signature p q. So say p minus 1s and q 1s. Gamma i's are called generators. Gamma i's are generators on the theta. So, from this we see that t and a tilde generate. Okay, because squares are minus ones. Okay, so you pick up two minus signs. And of course, the antipode. E a tilde is equal to a tilde, okay, which is also part of this. Now, T and a tilde are not on the same thing. Okay, so what is our goal? T is a fixed matrix. Okay. T I wrote down explicitly. Okay. It has a fixed action on the seats. Okay. You are going to change. Our goal is to find all possible A-tildes or classify possible A-tildes. Satisfy certain relations. Satisfy these relations. Okay. For every such A-tilde, we have a representation of a three-fold algebra. Or signature 2 symmetry. But one of the generators of the Clifford algebra is fixed. Okay? We are not looking for all possible representations of the Clifford algebra, which allows for changing a tilde as well as t. Okay? So the problem of finding the space of a tildes is a problem of finding all possible representations of the Clifford algebra 2-0, okay, with one generator fixed. Okay? T we are not going to change. Okay? T is fixed. A tilde is arbitrary. A tilde is something you have to figure out. Okay? So, the space of A tilde is a classification problem that space of representations defensive space of the element. So which means that Hamiltonian has to commute with the number operator. So the number operator in the original variable was sum over k, dj dada dj. But when you write in terms of the c's, you can check basically that this is 2i sum over j equal to 1 to n c to j minus 1 c. And this I can rewrite as sum over jk equal to 1 to n y q jk c j c. Okay, q was the matrix. Q was the matrix. 0, 1, minus 1, 0, 0, 0, 0. Okay, there's a rewriting of this. C1, C2, plus C3, C4, plus C5, C6, and that's this. So you want Hamiltonian to be time reversal invariant, because that condition is already imposed. Now we also want the Hamiltonian H tilde, right? The H tilde should commute with this number of what that we call as N. N. H tilde should commute with N. And I'll leave it as an exercise to check the exercise. Now this implies the following relation between the matrices. It implies that A field A, the matrix A field A, that appears in the Hamiltonian, commutes with B. And you have the relations q square equal to minus I minus 1. That's explicitly verified for you. And another exercise to check that q at the commutes minus I. This is also straightforward, right? P is a given matrix that I have already said. Written down. Q is that matrix. Then you can check that qp and minus q are the same. So roughly where you are heading to.
So P was a 4x4 matrix, Q is arbitrary.
Yeah, so you think of Q, yeah, P was C, okay. P was a 4x4 block.
Okay.
But you have to take the blocks of 4
multiples.
Yeah. So there are 4 n variables, you take the blocks of P and repeat it n times. Okay. So similarly Q, so if when you said P and Q, Q you have to think of as this block. And so it's the same block which repeats. Okay, so when you say P and Q and P commutates in that sense.
So N is even. N is even.
N is even, exactly. Right? So time reversal symmetry requires that N is even, small n is even. Already. Okay, so what we are heading to is to reinterpret this as a T4 algebra. Okay? But you have a problem because this is a commutator. Right? T4 algebra, this would have anti-commutator. Okay, so you have to do something more to make it into a T4 algebra. Okay. And it turns out that it's not very difficult. Okay. So you define E1 equal to P, E2 equal to QP. Okay. And then again it's a straightforward exercise to check that you have U1 square equal to minus 1, U square equal to minus 1. U1 into E minus into U1 and then U1 A tilde is minus A tilde U1 E2 A tilde is minus A tilde U2 and A tilde square minus 1. So U1 into A tilde okay. And a classification problem again is that you are trying to find all possible real representations of before 3-0 but with two generators fixed. Okay, because the generators T, U1 and E2, okay, these are fixed matrices. Okay, so you fix this and we look for all possible A tildes, okay, such that U1, E2 and A tilde generate before algebra with signature 3-0. Okay, and of course you can generalize this. Yeah, as a mathematical problem, we can generalize this for P4P. Okay, you fix some of the generators, okay, yeah, except one, and then you try to classify all possible representations order pi alpha. So general problem. Okay, it's not a most general problem, but let me, it's more general than what you have so far.
So here we do not have any of the generated fields.
No, you are an inward fields.
Oh, you have never fixed there.
You have never fixed. So it's always that you have certain number of the only, it's all about one of fields. So a general problem is that given P, okay, as you have said, the generators whose squares is minus 1 are called negative generators. Okay, generators whose squares to power plus 1 are called positive generators. Okay? We have only negative generators because we have a signature PC. So given P negative generators, find all possible matrices in P lambda. Okay, so P of the generators are fixed, you find the P plus 1. Okay, that's a general problem, and the problem we have encountered so far are for P equal to 0, 1 and 2, but you can certainly think of this is a more general problem. P equal to 0 here will be no symmetry, P equal to 1 is time reversal symmetry, and P equal to 2 will be time reversal symmetry and part of the
number. Yes, you were looking at real experiments.
Yes, so really. So, all there. Negative here. We are only looking for it. Now I'll state a result which are not true. But you can find the proof in that paper, and it's quite elementary. It's all straightforward algebra. Which is that this is equivalent to the problem. An explicit construction which tells us how we can take a representation of the three-fold algebra with negative generators and convert this to a representation of the three-fold algebra with positive generators but with two extra generators. Okay, it's basically that the construct is implies out of the E's and some additional sigma matrices. Okay, the analysis is quite straightforward. But it's somewhat easier to work with positive characters. This space we call RT plus 2. Okay, P plus 2 generator sticks, and you are trying to find a P plus 3 area. And now you see why our original space was R2, that was a P equal to 0 case. Okay? No symmetry, when there was no symmetry, that was a P equal to 0 case of this. In this language, that will be R2. Okay, so the relevant cases from this are R2, R3, and R4. Okay? But as a mathematical problem, of course, one can calculate R for all P. Even for P less than. After P equal to 0, 1 can go, right? Given no, you are looking for a representation of one dimension P for I. Yeah, so P for 0, 1. Okay, or nothing specified, okay? Find all possible matrices in the equilibrium. Which are positive, positive.
Can one
attempt
to make
P
equal to
minus 1,
say?
P equal to minus 1, I don't know what to mean. P equal to 0 means that you have no given generators and you are looking for one generator which squares to 1. Right? P equal to minus 1, there are no matrix left over, right? Plus 1 is 0. So these spaces in fact have all been classified. Okay, R is. So for example, R2, we have already seen, is limit n goes to infinity, open by limit. R3, for example, is, well, this limit is always the same, as n goes to infinity, u2n by sp. R4 is more complicated. This is infinity. This is symmetric too. It's similar to what we had last time for the complex. And so on. Okay. And one can also find out the pi 0, the number of disconnected components, okay, at the corresponding K group. Oh, I should have said, I forgot to discuss the K group for that, for this case. Okay. But you can easily figure out the K group. Okay. For here we found there are two elements, right? Okay, there is one corresponding to one Hessian, one another corresponding to Hessian minus one. The K group, you can, the group structure you can easily figure out. There is Z group. Okay, it's a group of additions. Okay, the group group of multiplication generated by 1 and minus 1. Okay, because Hessian, if you take two elements of Hessian 1, their product has Hessian 1. If you have Hessian 1, Hessian minus 1, the product is Hessian minus 1. Right? So that gives a group structure. So let me write down the and R1 is for example O2N. Again, limit. Okay. But more important for us is the pi zeros of this space, right? Because that's what gives the classification. So the pi zero of R1 is equal to O2N is has two disconnected components. Pi zero of R2, of course, we have already seen. Pi zero of R3 is empty. Zero. Pi 0 of R4 is there. Yes, and it turns out that there is a periodic structure. Which is an R U plus 8
in R.
Okay, so this is the origin of the title, periodic plane. Okay, this space R, okay, has this periodic plane. Okay, this is well known mathematical result. Okay, and I mean for those who are familiar with Dirac algebra, okay, this is know that there is a certain kind of periodicity of what kind of representation one gets, okay, which is period of 8. 2 and 10, for example, are very similar as far as the reference. Okay, so this is the general periodic structure, the R2 plus 8 and R2 plus 8. Okay, now I will take 5 more minutes to tell you why all this is useful. Because so far it looks like from whatever we have done, we have just had to classify finite dimensional hamming, right? Which doesn't look like a very exciting problem, right? And in the normal context of physics, you don't encounter finite dimensional hamming, right? Typically, there's a band which has infinite amount of space. But it turns out that once we have understood these results, then most of the interesting results that we would want to know, but they can be obtained from these by using various known theorems in case. Okay, and I'll just give one example. So take what are called band insulators. Indeed. Okay, so what are band insulators? They are basically field bands.
These are also the K3 groups?
Yes, they are all K3 groups. Right? Otherwise, it will not be a group in general. Right? To make this pi 0 into a group, right, you need some composition property, okay. And composition always requires that you have to use matrices of different dimensions, right? Because a composition of A and B you define as using log diagonal form of A and B. Okay. So, as a this makes sense as a group only if you use K-theorem.
What was the definition for
R1? For R1, by this, that you think of a positive generator, so take P equal to 1. Imagine that you are, so this problem didn't appear in our analysis, okay. Because we started from the negative generators, right, and they have got mapped to R p plus 2. But as a mathematical problem, you can define it, right? Just a classification problem for Q40p. Yeah, then R1 comes there. That when we try to classify Q402, right, given one fixed generator, right, that's R1. Now, R1 hasn't appeared in the problem that we analyze, but it will appear in what I am going to describe now. So the band insulators in D-dimension, okay, it's described by a general Hamiltonian topology form. These are momentum. Okay, you integrate over momentum. Okay. And typically you integrate the momentum in the Brillouin zone, which is periodical iron. Right? So it's like a torus. Okay, if you take a simple Brillouin zone, then the momentum that the momentum space is a torus, right? Because of the lattice structure. So this is integrated, say, over a d-dimensional torus. Right? D-dimensional torus is basically a product of these circles. In each direction, you have to assume that K has a periodic angle. So, at a somewhat crude level, okay, one can make it finite. P is, you can think of as a map from PV. R2 plus 2. Ok? these are functions of P. Okay, so these are not just fixed matrices anymore, they are functions of P. Okay. So you are actually finding a map from the distortance to the space of allowed form of a field as AK, okay, which you have defined in this RP plus 2, where P equal to 0 for no symmetry. P equal to 1 for time reversal invariants and P equal to 2 for time reversal plus 5. So now the problem is much more complicated, right? Because now what is the question we will be asking? We will be asking that given two such maps, one map from TD to R2 plus 2, that means one set of functions, and another set of functions, is there a continuous path that deforms one to the other? Okay, now these are infinite dimensional spaces, right? Because they are functions. We are asking for maps and the functions. Given two functions, can you continuously deform one to the other? So the in topological inequivalent class of these functions, okay, that is typically denoted as pi PV RP. So this is just a symbol, this basically means that these are the topological inequivalent class of maps from PV to R2, that means functions which whose arguments lie in PV and whose value lies in R2. What? How many topological inequivalent classes it has, right? What is the corresponding k? So this is what we are asking. So a priori it's a very complicated problem, right? You have to redo the analysis again, right? And now we are asking for deformation of functions. But it turns out that using various results of k theory, yeah, this is where the real part of K-theory comes in. One can show that this is the same as and these are already known. By 0 RQ, then you calculate once and for all, you can tabulate. Okay, you only need like 8 results, right? Because RQ has a periodicity. Okay, so once you have gotten those 8 by 0 of RQs, then you can use them to determine quantities. So let's look at the example. So this is what we have discussed, D equal to 3, Q equal to 4. So Q is plus 3. So Q equal to 4 corresponds to this case, right? Where you have time reversal and number conservation. What is the number conservation? So in this case, this is given by y0 of R4, that is equal to 0 dot, plus 3. 3 combination 1, that's 3, pi 0 of R3, plus 3 pi 0 of R2, plus pi 0 of R1.
What
I'll explain what this sum is. Or product, I mean, depending on how you So these are X-ray vertices. Okay, as a group, it's probably better to write as a product. Okay, so instead of writing some, I think we're writing a product. Let me write it as sum.
Okay.
Easier that way. Okay, what else? The interpretation. So pi 0 r 4 is how much? Pi 0 r 4 is 8. Sorry, pi 0 r 4 is 8. So this is 8 plus 3 pi 0 of r 3. Pi 0 of r 3 is 0. Okay. Then 3 pi 0 of r 2. So 3 is 8. Plus pi 0 of r 1. That is it. Okay. So this is plus 4z. Okay. So what this means is that these maps are classified by 5 integers a1, a2, a3, a4, a5. Where a1 can take value from minus infinity to infinity. So a1 belongs to z. And a2, a3 a2, a3, a4 and a5 take value from value 0 or 1. Okay, so I can also write as an ai. 0 or 1. And the group composition law, okay, if you have two such maps, right, if you want to compose in the sense of K-theory, okay, the first one will just add, okay, because that's the group set. Second one, A2 plus A2 prime, will follow the rule that 0 plus 0 is 0, 0 plus 1 is 1, but 1 plus 1 is 0. Right, because it's 8, 1 plus 1 is 2, which is 0, 1. And the same thing is for A3, A4, and A5. So this then is the K group of this map. Okay, so this means that these band insulators will be classified by these 5 integers. The first one is an arbitrary integer, the rest are Z1. Okay, so, and similarly there are various other examples you can find in the actual part. Okay, you can basically express the K groups of this complicated problem.
Why not a part 3 or 0, right?
Yes, that's what I wrote.
3?
Oh, 3 came from pi dot of R2. Oh, this is only also 3 here. You got S in the process of, because it's P combination S, right? So, this is, so it's best to write it as a sum. Even though it's recreated really a product as a group. Okay, but the reason that we write it as a sum is because then this decombination S becomes clear, otherwise you have to raise it if you have put it in the exponent. Okay? You can write Z2Q, but it really means it's Z2Q. Okay, but you just write it as Z2 plus Z2. So this, essentially, this is the usefulness of using the language of K-theory. Okay. That you can use various results, known results in K-theory, to solve these complicated problems in terms of the simple matrix problem that we have described. Okay, which involves just kind of pi 0 polynomials.
So here, as we are increasing the number of symmetries, we are have to consider more and more these
generators. Yes.
So from here we saw that there is just a periodicity of A. Does it mean that I cannot go beyond more than 8, I cannot impose more than 8 symmetries?
No, you can use more than 8 symmetries, because the K group will come back to the original. Okay. The K groups are periodic. Yeah. Right? The classification space is periodic, but you can certainly use K in principle, okay, probably in Padmeswara people don't want to use more than 8 symmetries, right? But I mean, in principle, there is nothing which prevents you from going to Clifford algebra of arbitrary kind.
Yeah, but these symmetries are, I mean, these are arbitrary, and then we are getting a structure.
Yeah, well, this structure that you are getting is on the representations of that Clifford algebra. And the point is, representations are periodic. So the classification problem in 2 dimensions and 10 dimensions are the same. That doesn't mean that 2 dimensional theory is equivalent to 10 dimensions. These are the topological classes are the same. That is getting to a 10 dimensional.
So there is nothing more.
No, I don't think there is anything more than. What is the interpretation? Yeah, in principle you can try and go back and try to interpret. In fact, that's, people have already classified many of these topological accelerators earlier. So in terms of those, you can try to classify. But if you just use the general result in K-theory, you wouldn't know offhand what the interpretation is, right? Because you are using a general result which equates this to this. Right? To interpret this, you have to know how this equality came.
Can you deduce
these
numbers from the experience?
Yes, you can in principle. Then, but that's why I said that originally people classify topological insulators directly by looking at maybe not the experiment but specific theoretical numbers. Right? And then this general classification scheme, basically everything falls into this general classification scheme. And an idea is that once you know the pi 0 of R cubes, you can convert these complicated problems in terms of these pi zero values, which are just representations of the
point. Sir, this integer has to be a simple map from G to R to G to R, or it could be section of some bundle R to goes to the point. To K integer to be a simple map from G to R to
G. Well, I don't know how it, I mean, for every T, point in T, there is a K tilde. And if you know the Hamiltonian, right?
Yeah.
So the Hamiltonian should be well defined.
Yeah.
Right? So you shouldn't have to.
So this map cannot be twisted.
Well, I mean, in some sense it is twisted, in the sense that I mean, it's that you cannot deform one map to the other, right? The very fact that there are defined classes means that you cannot deform one map to the other. Right? So clearly there is some topological obstruction to relate arbitrary maps. Otherwise the one equal has to be well defined, the Hamiltonian has to be well
defined. So for P equal 1, so you have said that we have the time vector subsymmetry, but could we get use another symmetry like the number of conservation or any other symmetry instead?
Yes, so we did use number of conservation, right? The one, if we didn't have time reversal symmetry but we had number of conservation, then you go back to the case that we analyzed yesterday. Right? This one has time reversal symmetry and number conservation. Right? You can add, as long as you have time reversal symmetry, then you can add arbitrary number of additional generators. And basically you get one more amount of generators.
So can you do it without time reversal?
If you use low time reversal and number conservation, then that's the problem that we discussed yesterday.
But in this case, you can use the same. It's not the same classification.
No, there it will be the classification of complex.
Right?
There it's like, I mean, you will have, instead of having R, right, which is real value, we will classify C. Right? And that has a different structure altogether. In fact, there, the periodicity is 2. Okay, once you have classified for C0 and C1, you have got C2.
Pi 0 will be integers because that was the K yesterday.
What?
The K group will be integers. All integers. Z. That was the integers here.
That's
it.
That's it. Yeah.
Sir,
so,
our system has more than 2 symmetries.
Yes.
And different set of symmetries. Mm-hmm. And I will get the same R cube for the both systems.
Yeah, the system has both symmetries. So when you talk about the Hamiltonians which are interpolating, right, you are looking for Hamiltonians maintaining those symmetries which interpolate between them.
Yes, sir.
And then you are saying that the number of independent topological classes of such Hamiltonians is phi 0 of R.
We can have like two set of systems. There are two Hamiltonian.
Yes.
Both have the same symmetry, two symmetries. This
exactly.
is this Hamiltonian, this Hamiltonian.
Yes.
We are connecting them. And
by Hamiltonians, which also have the same symmetries.
Yes, the same symmetry.
Yes.
Then I can have another system of two Hamiltonians, and I'm connecting them with two different set of symmetries.
Two different set of symmetries.
Symmetries.
So that means you are breaking some symmetry.
They are totally different systems.
Yeah, so in that case the problem reduces to having no symmetry at all, right? Because if you are using interpolating matrices which do not respect the symmetry, then that means you are not inventing also use of the symmetry, right? So then you go back to the case where there is no symmetry.
Sir, I am asking, I have two systems.
Yes.
In both system there are two symmetries. In both system there are two Hamiltonians which I am deforming into each other.
But which are two different symmetries? Are
two different set of symmetries.
That means the intermediate Hamiltonians have no symmetry, right? If the original Hamiltonian had one set of symmetries, the second one has a different set of symmetries.
Yes,
sir,
same set of symmetries.
Same set of symmetries. So like P and Q that we use here.
Yes, yes.
Right? Okay. And then the intermediate Hamiltonian have P and Q.
They are
the
same symmetries.
That's right.
But number of
symmetries
are two.
Two, yes, that's right. We have two, right?
And then, sir, for that system, I will get one RQ.
You will get that, that's R2. That's R4.
That's
yeah, you will get one RQ, yes.
Yes, sir. And there is another situation where there are two different Hamiltonians.
Yes.
And they are connected by two different symmetries.
Yes.
And then for that also, I will get R4.
No, for that you will not get R4 because if you have two different Hamiltonians, right? Suppose you have H1 tilde and H2 tilde, right?
Yes, sir.
This has some symmetry, this has a different symmetry. Okay. Then the Hamiltonian that interpolates between the two cannot have any symmetry, right?
I think what he is asking is the interpolating, interpolating matrices.
Yes.
They, should they have the same symmetry? If they do not have the same symmetry as H1 and H2.
That means that you are basically saying that the Hamiltonian doesn't have any symmetry, right? If the interpolating matrix doesn't have that symmetry, right? Then you go back to the case, right? Which is having no symmetry at all. Right? You use the corresponding R, right? For that case where there is no symmetry.
I
will
ask.
So if you have two symmetries, say time reversal and Q, right? Then you got pi 0 of R4, right?
Right.
Yes.
Now if I have two different symmetries, G1 and Q1.
P1 and Q1.
I mean they might not be time reversal or I don't know what.
Well, it depends on if you follow the P4 algebra, right?
Yes,
sir. If you follow the P4 algebra, you will get the same pi 0 of R4. Right? Because this this analysis is based on the representation of the P4 algebra, right? So, as long as if you have, suppose you have time reversal and some other symmetry, not particle number but something else, right? But such that you can generate a P4 algebra, then the classification problem will be the same. Because the classification problem that we have that has a pi 0 of R4, right? That only depended on the fact that these generate a key for R4, right? This didn't depend on the specific structure of the matrix that we have.
The Karnaugh quartic comes in the Hamiltonian which fits the symmetry.
Yes. Yeah, so in general, this is a p-formal classification. So in the presence of interaction, I mean you can use this classification only if the interactions are small enough so that they don't close the gap. Right? Then you can use effective free Hamiltonian and use this classification. But in general, if the interactions are such so big that the gap can be closed, then you have to redo the classification.
So
you
have to look at the renormalized
mark level. Exactly. Yeah. Okay, I mean it may even happen that it's a very strongly interacting system. The quasi particle description itself may not be there.
Thank you. the system is still strongly interacting, but I can say, suppose give to some quadratic of CC or something, and effectively in some regime I get a quadratic Hamiltonian. In that regime, this works.
Yeah. So the way, as long as I can describe the system in terms of quasi particles, right? The original particles may not be free. But if you can think of this as a quasi particle Hamiltonian, or nearly free quasi particle Hamiltonian with gaps, then you can use this kind of.
Is there any direct way to see how this infinite thing to, I mean, you are just equating using results from K-theory?
Yeah, if you want to do direct way, you have to go back to the K-theory and see how they derive the results, and then from there you can see the direct way, right? Because in general it's a very complicated, it's a very complicated series of, it's a result of several theorems which eventually will go from the top to the bottom. Right? So I don't think there
is a motivation also that something like this should come.
Well, it's, as I say, it's a general results in case theory, right? I mean, classification of maps like this. I don't know if there is a simple derivation of these results. We can look at Peter's, well, I mean, he doesn't give a derivation of these results. Right? He gives the results and the references that they are. Yeah? But it's basically a book on case theory. So if you read that book, you will probably know all these results, right? And then you can give direct derivation to all of this.
Would you briefly comment on how these various cases appear on the confusion of difference?
Well, that's a completely different subject. That will have a string problem sometime or some other time. Basically, the point is this notion of adding, being able to add this 1 minus 1, 1 minus 1, right? That in the deep brain language corresponds to adding brains and brain and different brain, right? If you have n deep brains, you have an UN n by n matrix, right? Which describes the degrees of freedom. But you can add additional n1 and n1 brain and n1 anti-brain. And
whatever dimension or of that?
Whatever dimension, yeah. If you add N1 brains and N1 anti-brains, right? That increases the dimension of the matrix.
And
like
the space-time dimension
increases. Yeah, space-time dimension. All this is happening in the open space.
These groups, there have any simpler little interpretation?
Which groups?
This K group.
Yeah, there again is a classification of the dimensions. Yeah, the K groups that are used for classification of D-brains, because you can think of this as a non-trivial map. So again, you are trying to classify non-trivial classical solutions, and that you can reformulate as non-trivial maps from some space to the space of H fields on the brain and D-brain system. Yeah, and that classification again is given a couple of cases.
So it depends on
which
manifold you compactify
on? Yeah, it will depend on which manifold you compactify. The given spectrum also depends on which manifold you compactify.
Here only is the symmetry of my Hamiltonian is sufficient to classify the gaps in space.
Yeah, so once you specify that these are the symmetries that you want to impose, right, then you simply ask that what are the possible topological classes of Hamiltonians that you can get which cannot be deformed.
And sir, once I, in the end, so those different classes has to differ by some physical property.
Yes, that's right.
So there will be only one physical, there will be, for me, this, can I say, how many different properties will be there? And
well, in this case, for example, those different classes will be characterized by these five integers.
Yes, sir.
Right? So, different values of these integers will correspond to different physical properties. Right? Because there are different topological classes. Right? If you take an interface of any of these two materials, right? Two materials of different AI values, right? You will find out on the interface there must be a gapless modal. Right, because there is no continuously interpolate from one Hamiltonian to another Hamiltonian without going to zero eigenvalues.
they are different disjoint classes. So there will be another sum property will be in
but this analysis just based on case so will not tell you precisely what properties are defined, right? Because what are you have to understand how the maps are defined. That you are not, I mean, what I have described so in this, right? I have not told you precisely what the maps are.
Right, but can you tell me that what is the minimum number of physical properties that are sufficient to classify my classes in that particular set?
That is only after you have determined this group. Right? Here, for example, you know that you need these 5 different numbers to classify the insulator, right? But how many numbers you get, it will depend on what is the corresponding k. Right? Because this tells us the number of independent possibility, right? So after you have determined it, you know how many guesses you need to classify.
So
sir,
if I get set of 5 integers,
yes,
will that tell me that there will be 5 different properties?
No. Well, it depends on what exactly you mean with that. Call it 5 different properties, right? But these are just integers, right? Any integer differs, the property will differ. Right? It's not that you can say one is conductivity, one is thermal conductivity and so on, right? So it's not high different properties in that sense. Yeah, at least there is an a priori guaranteed that you can actually think of these 5 different integers as 5 different properties in the conventional sense. Then it may happen, but what I have to understand precisely how these integers appear in the